asked to cite a very basic law of physics, many people reply with something that they might call the law of inertia. You've heard it. An object at rest tends to stay at rest, and an object in motion tends to stay in motion. This would-be law of physics suffers from some big problems. Its first half seems obvious. Its second half seems obviously wrong. And the whole thing sounds imprecise. Tends to? This is supposed to be a law of physics. There shouldn't be any tends to's in physics. Either it does or it doesn't. We'll get the real law of inertia soon, and there won't be any tends to's in it. But for now, it will help to look at this term inertia and to understand why it's often described as a tendency. Inertia is a tendency to resist changes in motion. Are there degrees of inertia? Yes. Some things have a greater tendency to resist changes in motion than others. Of course, a full suitcase resists changes in motion more than an empty suitcase does. Just try wiggling them. It's much easier to wiggle an empty suitcase than a full suitcase. Likewise, a leaf may dance in the breeze, but a stone certainly doesn't. The leaf and the stone have different amounts of inertia, and so do the two suitcases. We can make this more accurate. We can even measure inertia. The measure of an object's inertia is called its mass. That's what mass is, the numerical or quantitative indicator of inertia, the measure of an object's tendency to resist changes in motion. The more mass something has, the more it resists changes in motion. A stone has more mass than a leaf. A full suitcase has more mass than an empty suitcase. Notice that size has nothing to do with this. The two suitcases may have the same size, but the full one has much more mass and more inertia. The stone may be smaller than the leaf, but it has more mass and more inertia. And we're not talking about weight either. Sure, a full suitcase weighs more than an empty suitcase, but you can tell that without wiggling either. We'll explore weight later on. It's not the same as mass, and knowing this is very important. The wiggle test is the key to understanding mass and to understanding inertia. If you want to know how much mass something has, wiggle it. Try to change its state of motion. Back in RP2, the second taproot episode of Radical Physics, we encountered two very deep ideas that have no explanation. We took them for granted. These are the ideas of distance and time. Now we have a third fundamental idea to take for granted, namely mass. Mass is every bit as fundamental and mysterious as distance and time. Even though distance and time are mysterious, we know how to measure them, and that's crucial. Distance is measured with a ruler or meter stick, and its agreed upon unit of measurement is the meter. Time is measured with a clock or stopwatch, and its agreed upon unit is the second. Since mass is as deep and important as distance and time, we'd better learn how to measure mass, and we'd better have a unit for mass. The unit of measurement for mass is easy. It's the kilogram. Around the world, people agree on that. What we don't have is a conceptually clear and practical way to measure mass. Remember, the key is the wiggle test. We need a device that systematically wiggles an object. Then that object's resistance to wiggling, its resistance to changes in motion, can tell us the object's mass, can tell us its inertia. To measure mass, we need something like a paint shaker. Astronauts have such a device for measuring their bone and muscle loss while floating for long periods in space. But we need something smaller and cheaper that I can show you here in the gamma sector of the Milky Way. Such a device to measure mass would be called a massometer. I would load an unknown mass into its keeper. Maybe this. I would nudge the keeper, and because of the attached spring, the keeper would then vibrate back and forth. The massometer would time the rate of vibration and read out the object's mass. High mass objects would vibrate slowly. Low mass objects would vibrate quickly. What a useful instrument this would be. And what a great teaching tool. But as of mid-2012, no company on Earth manufactures a massometer. Wonderfest, the educational nonprofit corporation that produces radical physics, is ready to share credit for and benefits from massometer usefulness. But no science equipment company has stepped forward to build and market it. Distance, time, and mass are called the three fundamental physical dimensions. There is just one other fundamental dimension that we will need to take for granted in this huge arena of classical physics. But we won't need that here in radical physics until around episode 100, RP100. Until then, we are studying the incredibly rich territory of classical mechanics. And every new concept that we encounter in classical mechanics will be based upon these three fundamental physical dimensions: distance, time, and mass. We began this episode with a bad law of physics, a poor rendition of the law of inertia. Now that we understand inertia and its measurement as mass, we are prepared to grasp the real law of inertia, the first law of nature.
When you understand the laws of physics, Penny, anything is possible.